Dear ladies and gentlemen, dear colleagues, I would like to welcome you to the first panel of our Simon Wiesenthal Conference. My name is Philipp Rohrbach. I'm a historian working at the Vienna Wiesenthal Institute. And as you can see from the program, the first topic of our panel is from the Iberian Galicia to Eastern European Galicia, anti-Semitic radicalization and responses to it. And in this context, I would like to introduce the first speaker to you, Alphonse Aragoneses. He's a lecturer in legal history at the University Pompeu in Barcelona. He holds a PhD in law. His research is currently focused on law, collective identity, and collective memory, and he has published several texts on comparative law and the law of Franquismo. The talk he's giving today is about Spain and the Jews, from Filo-Sefardismo to Francoist antisemitism, and I'm looking forward to his presentation.
Vielen Dank, Philipp. Liebe Kolleginnen und Kollegen, guten Tag. Ich freue mich sehr, hier in Wien zu sein. Deswegen bedanke ich mich sehr für die Einladung und für die Großzügigkeit des Wiesenthal Instituts und auch für die tolle Organisation. Also danke, Herr Raski, Frau Kovac, Frau Ander, danke alle für die Einladung. Also, I'm going to talk about Spanish antisemitism. In Spain, there was and there is antisemitism, even if there was no, there were no Jews from 1492. And I'm started talking about law which was passed by the parliament in 2015. In June of 2015, the Spanish Official Gazette published the Bill 12/2015 granting the Spanish citizenship to Sephardim with Spanish origins. Jewish communities in Spain and abroad welcomed the law, which opened a gate to the right of return of Sephardic Jews. The English version of this law can be found in the internet, mostly in web pages of law firms, Jewish organizations, and also in the webpage of the Spanish Ministry of Foreign Affairs. But these institutions forgot something important. They didn't translate the preamble, the introduction, or what Marie-Thérèse Fergen called the song of the law. I know that the song of the law, the preamble, is not important for lawyers or Sephardic Jews who want to get the Spanish citizenship, but in my opinion, it has a very important symbolic and political content. Let's analyze it a little bit. The introduction, the preamble, explains different historical episodes, starting with the expulsion of the Jews in 1492. But here, the Catholic kings didn't expel the Jews from Spain, but some unspecified imperatives of history forced the Jews to convert, and only a few of them took the radical, the drastic way to leave the country. So there's a sort of shared responsibility, according to this law, between the Spanish kings and the Jews in the expulsion of the Jews. The preamble refers also to the period we are studying here, 19th and 20th century. And the preamble explains how Sephardic the Spanish kings were, that already at the end of 19th century, the kings facilitated the settling of Jews in Spain, that in 1924, during the monarchist dictatorship of Primo de Rivera, a law was passed granting Spanish citizenship to Sephardic Jews, and according to this preamble, this made possible for some Spanish diplomats to save hundreds of Jews a moment during the Holocaust, a moment in which, I quote, the brutal sacrifice of thousands of Sephardic Jews made the eternal link between Spain and the memory of the Holocaust. So according to this preamble, the kings didn't expel the Jews. According to this preamble, Spain was also Philo-Semitic and welcomed always the Jews. And according to this preamble, Spain was on the side of the saviors during the Holocaust, and Francoist cooperation with Hitler and the cooperation of Franco in the Holocaust is not mentioned. This is understandable, not justifiable, but this is understandable. Spain wants to participate in the global cosmopolitan memory of the Holocaust Professor Schneider was talking about before. And Spain decided to be on the side of the saviors, on the side of the good ones. This is, of course, understandable. Which is not so understandable, which is a little bit surprising, is the language of this preamble. This preamble used old-fashioned expressions. The Sephardic Jews didn't have rancor. They were always fieles, vital to Spain. They all have a cosmopolitan and pragmatic identity, and they suffered a brutal sacrifice to refer to the Holocaust. If you add to this language the fact that the Spanish Parliament denies that the Jews were expelled from Spain, you get a picture which is not inspired in the modern approaches to the Holocaust or to the modern approaches to Second World War, but it's more linked to the old-fashioned approach by the Spanish elites to the Sephardic Jews, this filosefardismo. In the following minutes, I'll try to describe this filosefardismo, these intellectual constructions of the Spanish elites, and I'll try to explain how this filosefardismo, philosephardism, was compatible with a much more open anti-Semitism in Spain. As I was saying, there were no Jewish Jews in Spain. The French Revolution allowed the Jews to be citizens and to enjoy some rights, but not in Spain. All the constitutions until the end of 19th century, all the Spanish constitutions established that the Spanish nation was Catholic and that all the other religions were banned. But at the end of 19th century, some circumstances allowed a philo-Semitic, or better said, a philo-Sephardic discourse. First circumstance, at the end of 19th century, there was an incipient industrialization and globalization of the Spanish economy, and some Jewish families coming from Central Europe settled in cities like Madrid, Barcelona, and Valencia. Also at the end of 19th century, Spain was trying to colonize, to penetrate in Morocco. Remember that there was a protectorate established in 1912. And in this northern part of Morocco, there were Jewish families, there were thousands of Sephardic Jews, and Spain was interested in these Jewish families because these Jewish families could help Spain to penetrate Morocco. Spain was also witnessing how France was developing a network of French-speaking Jewish organizations in the Balkans through the Alliance Israélite Universelle, creating schools in French and obtaining the complicity of the Jewish elites in Eastern Europe. These circumstances, these political and economic circumstances, are at the origin of this filosefardismo, this discourse elaborated by the Spanish elites idealizing the Middle Ages, idealizing the convivencia, the living together of the three cultures, Islamic, Jewish, and Christian, during the Middle Ages, and trying to attract the Sephardic Jews, and trying to convince the Spanish authorities to approach the Sephardic Jews living in Morocco or in the Balkans. It is a very romantic discourse, idealizing the Middle Ages, and this discourse is also based on clichés. The Sephardic Jews, they are rich, the Sephardic Jews, they are cosmopolitan, and therefore these Sephardic Jews can help the Spanish economy. It's also very interesting that in almost all the texts, books, articles, speeches, etc., these Sephardic Jews are called Españoles sin patria, so Spaniards without a country, Sephardic Spaniards, and in a way, their Jewishness is hidden. So they are interesting for Spain because they are Spaniards, but their Jewishness is sometimes hidden. It's also very interesting to see the ambivalence of these philo-Sephardic authors. They want to approach the Sephardic Jews living in the Balkans or in Morocco, but at the same time, they want to prevent a Jewish immigration into Spain, because Spain didn't want to have a Jewish problem. Jewish presence in Spain meant Jewish problem, and Spain didn't want the Spanish elites and the Spanish politicians didn't want to have Jews in Spain. So it's philo-Sephardism without a specific philo-Judaism or philo-Semitism. This is maybe the most famous philo-Sephardita. He was member of the Senate, and he wrote this famous book, Españoles sin Patria. This is a very successful expression still today. And the last part of the book is called La Raza Sephardi. And it has to be said that this discourse, this philo-Sephardic discourse, has a very strong racial component. These authors are very much interested in showing that the Sephardic race is very close to the Spanish race, so that they are more Spanish than Jews, right? So we can incorporate them, we can give them Spanish citizenship because they are Spanish. And again, trying always to hide their Judaism. Which were the functions of this discourse? In my opinion, philo-Sephardismo played important functions in the political, social, and economic system in Spain, end of 19th century, beginning of 20th century. It helped the liberals to build a narrative about Spain, opposed to the narrative of the conservative Catholics. Spain was a young nation, like Germany or France, and had to write its own history, and the liberals tried to present the history of Spain as a history of tolerance, freedom, convivencia, etc., until the Catholic kings. And then, with the Catholic kings, a history of intolerance, persecution started. And the Spanish liberals were presenting themselves as the heirs of this tolerant of Spain, and they were presenting the Catholics or the Carlistas as the heirs of the Inquisición, Reyes Católicos, etc., etc. Second function, this philo-Sephardic discourse was used to legitimize the presence of Spain in Morocco. Spain had an experience of dealing with plurality, with different cultures, so Spain was better prepared than France or other countries to establish a protectorate in Morocco. And the same for Eastern Europe. The Ottoman Empire was in crisis, and all the European powers were interested in penetrating the Ottoman Empire, and Spain defended that because of the thousands of Sephardic Jews living in the Balkans, in Greece, or in Turkey, Spain had to deploy economic and diplomatic missions in these areas. So you see that this philo-Sephardic discourse, which has this light elements of anti-Semitism, played a political function in Spain at the end of 19th centuries. At the end of 19th century, beginning of the 20th century, this philo-Sephardic discourse allowed, made that this Spanish state legalized the Jewish communities. Synagogues were open in Madrid and Barcelona. And if you study the Spanish Gazette, you'll find many cases of naturalizations or nationalizations of Jewish families, especially in northern Morocco. It was not only philo-Sephardism or philo-Semitism, it was also the interest of Spain of having Spanish citizens in Morocco to help the work of colonization of Morocco. It has to be said that in 1924, during the monarchist dictatorship of Primo de Rivera and Alfonso XIII, a decree was published granting Spanish citizenship to all Sephardic Jews under certain circumstances. And it's very interesting because this decree doesn't use the word Jewish or Sephardic. This decree talks about Spaniards who lost the citizenship, Spaniards who have to regain the citizenship, but the word Jewish or the word Sephardic is absent in this law. But this decree allowed around between 3,000 and 4,000 Jews living mostly in the Balkans, in Greece, to get the Spanish citizenship. 1931 was the year of proclamation of the Spanish Republic. And during the Spanish Republic, anti-Semitism, which was very strong in Spain, exploded also thanks to the complicity of Nazi Germany. There have been anti-Semitism in Spain since the beginning of 19th centuries with two specificities. First, anti-Semitism with the Jews. Second, the confusion or union between Judaism and Freemasons. Freemasons were considered as Jews with a mask. And it's interesting to see that in all the propaganda, books, speeches, and the iconography also, in Spain, 19th century and 20th century, this fusion between Jews and Freemasons. Freemasons were to blame for all disgraces happening in Spain, the loss of the colonies, the liberal revolutions, the prosecution of priests. They were all the responsibility of Freemasons. And remember, Freemasons, there's this identification, this confusion between Freemason and Jews. And during the Spanish Republic, this exploded. The Second Republic was philo-Semitic. The Spanish Republic supported the Zionist project. And this is unfortunately forgotten in Spain. Nobody remembers this. The Second Republic received many refugees from Germany after 1933, and there was a Jewish, German-speaking life in Barcelona. There were two cinemas screening films in German for the German-Jewish refugees. And that fueled also anti-Semitism in Spain. There was this identification, Freemasons and Jewish. And in the 30s, there's also a interesting identification or confusion between Jewish and Catalan. And this can be found in many speeches and also in the anthem of Falange, this pro-fascist party, where there's a phrase saying, judío catalán renegado pagarás por el daño que has causado. So you, Jewish felon Catalan, you will pay for the harm you've done. 1936, also the coup d'etat which started the civil war was justified as a reaction against this Freemason Jewish conspiracy or Russian Jewish conspiracy. There were no specific acts of violence against Jews, even if the communities in Ceuta and Melilla were attacked and they were forced to finance the coup d'etat. Francisco Franco didn't use anti-Semitic rhetoric in general, but all his followers did use this anti-Semitic rhetoric. And this confusion between Jewish, Catalan, communists, Freemasons, etc., etc. It has to be said that in his speech of victory, Franco said that the Jewish spirit allowed the great alliance of capital with Marxism, and this Jewish spirit has to be extirpated from the consciences. So after the formal end of the war, the Jews were not targeted as a group, but Maite Ojeda, a researcher in Barcelona, has discovered recently that the anti-Freemason legislation, the lay for the repression of Freemasons and communists of 1940, was used also to repress, to prosecute Jews who were not Freemasons and were not Marxists, they were just Republicans. And there were some small episodes also in which proves this anti-Semitism. What happened between 1939 and 1945? A lot has been said about the Franco participation in the Second World War and about Franco's participation in the Holocaust. Some say that Franco helped some Jews to escape the Holocaust. Some others said that no, that he did the opposite. In my opinion, Franco did participate in Second World War. It was formally neutral, but he helped Adolf Hitler. And there are archive evidences of the participation of the cooperation of Francisco Franco during the Holocaust. You remember these 3,000, 4,000 Jews who got a Spanish pass in 1924. They were living in the Balkans. They were living in Central Europe. They were living in Greece. 1942, 1943, they knocked at the doors of the ambassadors in Greece, in Budapest, etc., etc. The ambassadors asked Madrid what to do. They were Jews, but they had Spanish passport, but they never put a foot in Spain. I can show you a document. I have some copies in paper if you want them, where the general director of European policy, Dusinage, says that this orders the representatives of Spain to be passive and not to interfere in the deportation of Jews and to ask the German authorities for the goods of the deported Jews, because the goods of the deported Jews were belong to Spain. With which legal argument? You can see it here. They were given Spanish nationality to help them, but they cannot be equalized to the Spanish who were born in Spain and grew up in the spirit and atmosphere of Spain. In my opinion, this sentence caused the denationalization of Spanish Jews who were Spanish citizens, and this allowed the German authorities to deport hundreds of Jews to the Nazi camps. I found another document, a very interesting document in the archive of the Spanish Ministry of Foreign Affairs. It's a letter of the German embassy, 1944, saying Spanish authorities asked us for the repatriation of the Spanish Jews. We offered them twice to repatriate their Jews. They always refused. And now, of course, we sent these Spanish Jews to the working camps in Poland. Unfortunately, I think the Nazis telling the truth. It is true that in 1944, when the war was coming to an end, then Franco ordered his diplomats to save Jews, and he allowed the Jews to cross Spain as the light crossed the window. Even the Jews with a Spanish passport, they were not allowed to settle in Spain. They were forced to leave the country. Why did Franco do this? It was the end of the war, and the Spanish politicians wanted to approach the victors, the United States and Great Britain. 1945, and now I'm coming to an end. Spanish authorities tried to start a propaganda campaign to convince the United States and Great Britain that Spain was philo-Semitic and that Franco helped thousands of Jews to escape. And this propaganda is at the origin of the myth of Franco as philo-Jewish or savior of Jews. Of course, some Spanish diplomats are among the righteous among the nations, and they saved thousands of Jews, but in many cases they were contradicting the instructions of Spain. And in other cases, it was 1944, 1945, when the Spain decided opportunistically to change its politics, its policies about the Jews. I come to an end. In my opinion, Spain is trying to, as I was saying at the beginning, to participate in this cosmopolitan memory of the Holocaust, presenting itself as savior of Jews and presenting the names of the Spanish righteous among the nations, but at the same time is trying to hide the Spanish complicity with Adolf Hitler, the Spanish complicity which is proved in archived documents with the Holocaust. If Spain wants to participate in this global cosmopolitan culture of the Holocaust, why not to derogate symbolically the edict of 1492 expelling the Jews, or why not to accept the Spanish responsibility in the Holocaust? In my opinion, if Spain approaches critically the memory of the Holocaust and the memory of its role in the Second World War, Spain has to approach also critically the civil war, the dictatorship, and the founding myth of Spanish democracy, the transición. And as Nathan Schneider was telling a few minutes before, this is really hard task, because if you question the transición, if you question the franquismo and you question the transición, you also question the continuities, the political, economic, and personal continuities of the dictatorship into Spanish current democracy. Well, thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much for this very interesting contribution. It is a pleasure to introduce our next speaker to you, Jonut Biluta. He holds a PhD in history from the Central European University in Budapest, and he's also a PhD candidate in theology at the Babes-Bolyai University and research assistant at the George Sinkai Institute for Social Science and the Humanities in Târgu Mureș, Romania. Jonut used to be a junior fellow at the Wiener Wiesenthal Institute in the academic year 2014 and 15. And the speech he's giving today is about the anti-Semitic turn of the Orthodox biblical scholarship in interwar Romania. Jonut, the floor is yours.
Okay, perfect. I will go directly to the paper and we will discuss it maybe during discussions and you will ask questions and maybe address suggestions to it. My paper focuses on the entanglement between anti-Semitism and Orthodox biblical theology in interwar Romania. Specifically, I point to the way in which the Jewish minority was perceived through the theological lenses of the Orthodox hermeneutics of both the Old and the New Testament, under the impact of the ultra-nationalist radicalization of its clergy. Moreover, for the fascist biblical scholars, borrowing heavily from the Nazi-infused theology, the Book of the Bible was a place of intellectually entrenched struggle against the Jewish authorship of the Old Testament in their constant search for a racially pristine corpus of the scriptures. Although defending the presence of the Old Testament in the canonical scriptures and the Jewish terms in the New Testament, the Romanian biblical scholars claim that contemporary Jews, as a degenerate race in commas, had no right to use the scriptures in their liturgy or to claim their authorship. The advent of different fascist parties in the middle of the 1930s, the most important being the National Christian Defense League and the Iron Guard, with their highly anti-Semitic and racist ideas embedded into their ideologies, deeply permeated and influenced the theological discourse of the Romanian Orthodox Church. From biblical scholarship to systematical theology, the stamp left by fascist anti-Semitism seduced professors and students alike in initially disowning and afterwards in persecuting their Jewish neighbors with criminal consequences. The reason why Orthodox clergy and theology students embraced the Iron Guard's anti-Semitic view is related to the theological academic milieu of Orthodox departments of theology. Discontent with the positivist, scholastic, academic method of teaching and the academic curricula unchanged in almost 50 years acquired from the German-speaking universities, but also from the late 19th century Russian systematic theology by the old faculty, a generational shift occurred in early 1930s, with young students looking for salient, irrational, radical intellectual alternatives with a highly nationalist, extremist political mindset. In this respect, the departments of Orthodox theology wholeheartedly embraced the nationalistic, anti-Semitic drive cultivated by radical fascist movements. Students in theology perceive the importance of radical ultranationalism and anti-Semitism as a form of missionary work they had to perform as the spiritual enlighteners of the masses. As a paradox, in the same time, many fascist theologians trained in the schools of Orthodox theology felt compelled to adhere to the principles of inter-Orthodox relations and ecumenism, of tolerance towards every human being, as explained by the concept of sobornost, preached by the Russian theology, and the rediscovery of the Church Fathers, known as the Neopatristic Renaissance. The modernity mesuere synthesis, culturally and aesthetically accompanying the rise of fascism, the association in the same narrative of opposite aesthetic or philosophical categories, determined the paradoxical fresh perspective of young students in theology. In the vertex of modernity, Christian theologians associated their love with the hate for their neighbor, their Christology grounded on Christ's commandment for love to the humankind with an almost ecumenical theological justification for the racial hatred directed against the Jews, the Romas, and other ethnic minorities. Accordingly, both in their writings and their public attitudes, the Orthodox clergymen played the double game as cutting-edge teachers of Orthodox doctrine and as missionaries of a radical anti-Semitic perspective embedded in a stern fascist nationalist worldview among their fellow clergymen and their students. As in the case of Nazi Germany, besides the social and economical reasons, the interest of theologians and Christian clergymen in the science of anti-Semitism was related to the innovative, avant-garde nature of synthesis between Christian theology and the narrative of racial hate. The innovative theological approach was a challenging and provoking research methodology for young scholars, offering them a scientific grounding for their theological racist idiom. The anti-Semitic change of theological perspective successfully materialized in the field of biblical scholarship, especially in that of Old Testament studies. The growing influx of anti-Jewish ideas streaming from Protestant theology, with its highlight on the hermeneutical, philological interpretation of the biblical text, and the fascist radicalization of the Orthodox clergy, determined biblical scholars to tackle the issue of anti-Semitism from a critical theological perspective. Father Nicolae Neaga, he was born in 1902, he died in 2003, a young professor of Old Testament studies in Sibiu Theological Academy and a much acclaimed supporter of the ultranationalist right, voiced his theological assumptions towards the relation between Judaism and Christianity with the intention of lampooning his Jewish neighbors and raising the racial awareness of his students. In an article published in the yearbook of the Sibiu Theological Academy relating to biblical anti-Semitism, therefore meant for young students in theology to read, Neaga stated the following, and I quote, "In the corpus of the scriptures, the writing of the prophets were the first proof of a dialectical anti-Semitism. In the age of the New Testament, instead of Israel, who failed to correspond with his divine calling, God chose a new nation to whom he commanded to win over new disciples for Christ and to keep forever awake the conscience of the Christian souls." I end the quote. In other words, Neaga claimed that Old Testament prophets represented the first anti-Semite voices and that it was the sacred duty of every young theologian to spiritually fortify his prophetic voice and therefore to embrace anti-Semitism as mandatory missionary weapon. Neaga undergirded his missional appeal with theological grounding by claiming that because of the biblical Jews' persistence into polytheism and in the constant neglect of their promise to God, the Christian covenant superseded the old one. Neaga vividly berated the Nazi theologians' assumptions, depicting Christianity as a Judaic religion, and attempted to clarify the relation between Judaism and Christianity from an Orthodox perspective. I quote from the same text, "Christianity considers itself not a new religion, even less as a reform of Judaism, but rather as a fulfillment of those commandments and God's promises which the religion of Old Testament virtually embodied. The fact that Christian Church sees in the Old Testament the first book of its sacred scriptures legitimizes this idea. If Christianity sweepingly clashed with Judaism, it was not because of the Christians that the initiative of a breach between the two religions came up. The Jews are the ones who disowned and rejected the Christians." I end the quote. Speaking in the context of Saint Stephen martyrdom from the Acts of the Apostles, Neaga attempted to prove the superiority of Christianity over Judaism, but also to state the fact that it was responsible for rivalry between the two religions. As a paradox, although sternly defending the Semitic origins of Christian religion and its founder, the scholar from Sibiu claimed that actually the Jews were responsible for provoking the split of the two religions in the same text where he advised his students to be ardent anti-Semites, following in the footsteps of the Old Testament prophets. Naga ended his text with a premonition that will materialize during the Romanian Holocaust. And I quote, "In what concerns the Gospels, they, the Jews, are its enemies." I end the quote. According to Naga, the Jews had to be persecuted because they were the enemies of the Gospel, preventing the teaching of Jesus from their fulfillment. Anti-Semitism metamorphosed into a sacred duty for every theologian aspiring to be a priest or a bishop in the Orthodox Church, hating and persecuting the Jews, determining them to convert to Christianity, and eventually the fulfillment of the Christian gospel. Also, as enemies, the Jews had to be deprived of their right to use Christian scriptures, because God turned his face and goodwill from them. The racist trends against the Jewish minority in Romania, voiced by Father Nicolae Naga, went hand in hand with an already existing anti-Semitic discourse developed inside the structures of the church. Continuing the late 19th century, obsession with Judaism as closely associated with the spread of Freemasonry, the bishops, the priests, and the theologians of the Romanian Orthodox Church rejected from the beginning these kinds of occult organizations perceived by them as being openly anti-Christian and the source of all malaise engulfing and containing the church initiatives in promoting a Romanian Orthodoxy. The Dean of Theological Faculty from Bucharest University, Father Ioan Popescu Mălăiești, he was born in 1874, he died in 1953, professor of Old Testament studies, published in 1938 a text addressed to the theology students, in which he bravely attempted to clarify the relations between the Jews and the Christians from the sophisticated perspective of the Orthodox theology. From the beginning of the text entitled Jews and Christians, the professor of Bucharest Theology Department presented them as a degenerate race, labeling Jews of his times as the decadent, pitiful remnant of the biblical chosen people. I quote from his text, "Under these kingdoms, little by little, the racial characteristics of the Jewish race, but also of the Jewish religious life and faith, faded away and completely disappeared. This was clear in the first century of Christianity. Then it became clear for everyone how much the Jews departed from the ways of those who wrongfully they considered their ancestors." I end the quote. According to Ioan Popescu Mălăiești, the decadence of the Jewish people apparently became visible in the moment when Christianity came into being, with the religion of Jesus standing as the fulfillment of the Jewish covenant. The rise of Christianity marked not just the process of founding a new religion, but also the last step in the racial decadence of the Jewish people. The moment when Christ was nailed to the cross sealed the fate of biblical Jews and doomed, according to the Romanian biblical scholars, to linger in moral and racial decay. From this point onwards, they failed to represent the chosen people of the Bible and transformed themselves into a Judaic nation. I quote again from Mălăiești's text. From that movement onwards, Christ's crucifixion, they bear the stamp of this awful curse. From this particular moment onwards, I believe that starts the life of the Judaic nation. I end the quote. As a theological stratagem meant to justify the presence of Old Testament in the corpus of the scriptures, Father Popescu Mălăiești claimed that because of this racial split between the Jewish and the Judaic nation, the sacred books of the two changed. Accordingly, instead of the Old Testament, the scripture of the Judaic nation became the Talmud with its legalistic precepts. In this respect, the Christian church succeeded the Jewish people as the depository of the initial revelation received in the desert from the Mount Sinai, and therefore the place of the Old Testament as related with God's revelation was assured in the corpus of the Christian scriptures. In these circumstances, as a paradox, the Romanian theologian envisaged that Jews and the Nazi and German Nazi theologians in the same melting pot, insinuating that even Nazi theologians asking for the removal of Old Testament from the Christian scriptures work in favor of Talmudic interest. I quote from his text, the kikes, sorry, this is his term, just as the contemporary heathens, the Nazis, asking for the removal of the Old Testament, are aware that by doing so, they obliterate the Christian faith. By attacking the Old Testament, they are doing a great service to the Judaic Talmud. I end the quote. The position of the Romanian biblical scholar tends to be paradoxical from various angles. Mălăiești claimed that Germanic and the Talmudic religion of Judaism are both conspiratorily envisaged by the Jews, with the only purpose in mind to eliminate the Old Testament from the scripture's corpus and to discredit Christianity. He even claimed that conversion should not be permitted to Jews, but the state had to keep the newly converted Jews under constant and close surveillance. I quote from his text, "The Jews should not be prevented from embracing the Christian faith. They should be welcomed, but afterwards kept under surveillance if they keep the faith which they have embraced." I end the quote. The singularity of his view in interwar Orthodox theology, although before 1938, Popescu Mălăiești opposed to any anti-Semitic manifestation in the Department of Orthodox Theology from Bucharest, signaled that under the anti-Semitic radicalization of the Orthodox clergy, the Romanian Patriarch included, even the most benign theologians fell in line with the racist views of the majority of the clergy. The same judgmental thinking which linked Freemasonry with world Jewry was expressed during Second World War by Deacon Nicolae Mladin. By recycling some of the arguments exposed by other biblical scholars before him, Mladin considered without a doubt that Judaism was a creation of the Talmud, and that the Talmud was a testimony of a satanic messianism, and that Old Testament belongs to Christianity, and Judaism belongs to the Talmudic spirit. I end the quote. In defining the link between anti-Semitism and Freemasonry, Mladin stated that, and I quote from his text, "Anti-Semitism is therefore directed not against the Old Testament, but against the Talmud that grew from the hatred against Christ and shaped the twisted physiognomy of the current Judaism. Freemasonry is the tool through which Judaism recruits, even from among the Christians, fighters against Christ. Obviously, we talk about people driven by material gains. The supreme leadership is held by the American kikes." Sorry, his term. I end the quote. The purpose of the so-called Jewish conspiracy embodied in Freemasonry was nothing more but, and I quote again from his text, "the Christianizing the people and keeping them enslaved by passions and desires under the yoke of the universal kingdom of Israel. This is why the Kahal and the Freemasonry are the brew for all the vices that destroy civilizations and crush the nations. Debauchery, Freudism, open marriage, sexuality, and so on, alcoholism, thievery, murder, capitalism, anarchy, fascism, communism. An instrument, it's almost everything, an instrument of public corruption, Judaism made out of religion, an opium of the people, from art, a shameless exhibition, from science, a weapon against God, from philosophy, a negation of Christ, from education, an instrument of spiritual mess, from the free press, a means to falsify the Romanian spirituality." I end the quote. By stating these facts clearly, Mladin presented also the consequences to those already who already followed the Masonic principles or simply had Jewish origins. According to him, there was no salvation for the Jews and the Freemasons, but rather the reality of eternal punishment in the hell's flames. And I quote, and this is the final conclusion of his text, "A terrible downfall awaits those who reject Christ and fall into the hands of Judah." Paradoxically, these Orthodox biblical scholars, while they use the analytical tools of Orthodox academic theology, in the interwar period under the influence of the radical right-wing fascist movements, they shift the finality of these theological approaches. They go from being focused on the salvation of the individual soul to the salvation of the nation. Also, they embark in a crusade against the Jewish authorship of the scriptures and the Torah, to prove the superiority of Christianity by contesting the legacy of the Jews as the chosen people by God. These biblical hermeneutics promoted the idea of the Gentiles, in their case the Romanian nation, as the chosen people. To place the nation in the beyond, in an Orthodox framework, they have to cleanse it from any ethnic and religious minority. The theological finality of the discourse that these Orthodox intellectuals produced, while well steeped in scriptural and patristic references, goes towards a collective salvation of the nation at the expense of an individual one, a heretical position that is not doctrinally accepted in the Orthodox Church, but is preserved at the level of intellectual religious discourse. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Junot. Our next speaker is Grzegorz Rosolinski-Liebe. He's senior researcher and guest lecturer at the Freie Universität Berlin, and he's also a postdoctoral fellow of the Jewish Claims Conference. In 2014, he published his dissertation about Stefan Bandera, the life and afterlife of a Ukrainian nationalist. And the topic he's going to talk about today is racism and modern anti-Semitism in Ukrainian Galicia. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for the invitation to this interesting conference and the kind introduction. I will talk about racism and modern anti-Semitism in the region, which is today a part of Western Ukraine and is ethnically homogeneous. But between 1880 and 1941, it was one of the most multi-ethnic regions in Europe. It was inhabited by Ukrainians, Poles, Jews, Germans, Armenians, Czechs, Romanians, and several other people. I will concentrate only on the Ukrainian racism and modern anti-Semitism, which means that I will not talk about the Polish, German, Russian, and other discourses which took place in Galicia at the same time. The Ukrainian racism and modern anti-Semitism have been much less investigated than the Polish and German anti-Semitism. We have many publications on Ukrainian nationalism, but with the exception of one article written by me, there is no single publication on racism and modern anti-Semitism in Ukraine, as far as I know, especially what the 19th century concerns. For the 20th century, we have some publication. So this is quite strange, given the number of historians who investigate the Ukrainian and Eastern European history and publish on nationalism, empires, transnationalism, or publish all possible kinds of memory studies. To explain the Ukrainian-Galician racism and anti-Semitism, I will concentrate on a few scholars and ideologists who either lived in Galicia or impacted the Ukrainian discourses in Galicia. But before I begin with this, I will shortly explain the political situation in Ukraine between 1880 and 1945, and I will mention the two most important reasons behind the racist and anti-Semitic thinking in Ukrainian Galicia. Galicia was the easternmost province of the Habsburg Empire. It was founded in 1772 by the Habsburg bureaucrats. As I have already mentioned, it was a multi-ethnic region, and Ukrainians constituted the majority of the population, although not in the cities. After the First World War, Galicia was included into the Second Polish Republic and it remained in Poland until September 1939. The majority of Ukrainians, about 80% of them, did not live in Galicia. Until 1914, they lived in the Russian Empire or Russian Ukraine, and after 1918, in the Soviet Union or Soviet Ukraine. So this is basically the geopolitical framework in which the Ukrainian modern racism and anti-Semitism occurred. Because of the specific political and social circumstances, these two modern phenomena became different than racism and anti-Semitism of nations who governed empires or lived in their own states. But of course, the discourses in Ukraine were influenced by discourses from the Habsburg Empire, Russian Empire, and very much from Poland and Nazi Germany. The two most important reasons behind the racist and anti-Semitic thinking in Ukraine and Galicia were related to the complicated Ukrainian history. The first was the lack of a state in which the inhabitants of the territory between Poland and Russia could be Ukrainized. In Russian Ukraine, there was a strong policy of Russification, especially after the Ems Ukaz from 1876, which banned using the Ukrainian language in print. Galicia was granted a political autonomy in 1867, but the political life was dominated by Poles who politically and economically suppressed the Ukrainians. The second reason is the similarity or indistinctiveness of culture and language. The Ukrainian language was and is still quite similar to the Polish and to the Russian language. After living together for centuries, the Polish and Ukrainian culture adjusted and blurred in Western Ukraine. In Russian Ukraine, the Ukrainian language was influenced by the Russian language. Mixed marriages were common in both parts of Ukraine. In Galicia, especially in the villages, Poles celebrated the Greek Catholic religious rituals and Ukrainians the Polish Catholic ones. And the two ethnic groups lived very closely together. So the Ukrainian and Polish culture became quite similar and even blurred, especially in Galicia. And the Ukrainian and Russian culture blurred in eastern and central parts of Ukraine. So given these two factors, the situation for Ukrainian intellectuals who wanted to create a homogeneous or monolithic Ukrainian nation was quite difficult in the late 19th century. How could they explain the Ukrainians in Galicia and in the Russian Empire that they were something different than their Polish and Russian neighbors? In the case of the Jews, it was easier, because the Jews dressed differently, at least in the villages, they usually spoke a different language, and they did not attend the Greek Catholic or Orthodox Church. Now I will switch to the main part of the presentation, and I will show how Ukrainian intellectuals started applying characteristics, races and racial characteristics, to distinguish the Ukrainians from the Poles and the Russians. The first two interesting cases are the historians Mykhailo Hrushevsky, who was born 1866 and died 1934, and the second is Volodymyr Antonovich, born 1834 and died 1909. Before I start, I have to say that these two historians introduced racial characteristics in their writings to invent the Ukrainian nation, but they were not racist in the sense that they disapprove of other people or claim that the Ukrainians are superior to Poles, Russians, or the Jews. What did they do? Hrushevsky, who after his death became the most famous Ukrainian historian and has today a monument in almost every town and city in western, central, and eastern Ukraine, separated Ukrainian history from Russian history and started looking for the origins of his fellow Ukrainians among ancient peoples. He argued that in ancient Ukraine, that the ancient Ukraine was inhabited by dolichocephalic, which is long-headed, and brachycephalic, which is short-headed, types of people. In the 19th century Ukraine, he found mainly short-headed Ukrainians and argued that this is a future which distinguished them from the Poles, who are long-headed, and the Russians, who are medium-headed. In general, an ideal type of a Ukrainian was for him blonde-haired, ruddy-skinned, tall, and very dirty. For Volodymyr Antonovich, who is today less popular than Hrushevsky, the skulls and the shape of the heads were also an important characteristic to distinguish the Ukrainians from the Poles and the Russians. He claimed that Ukrainians had oval skulls, Russians have round skulls, and Poles had long skulls. According to him, it was possible to distinguish an ideal type of a Ukrainian skull from an ideal type of a Russian and a Polish skull. Similarly, the Poles, Russians, and Ukrainians could be distinguished by comparing their physical appearance, especially the face and the shape of the bones. The legs of the Poles were longer than their torsos. Russians' legs were shorter than their torsos, and Ukrainians' legs were exactly as long as their torsos. Similarly, according to Antonovich, the Poles, Ukrainians, and Russians get fat differently. Poles accumulated fat on the belly, Russians on the neck, and Ukrainians on the chest. He also argued that there were different proportions of individuals with blue eyes and blonde hair among the Poles, the Russians, and the Ukrainians, and provided numbers based on anthropological publications. The next interesting and more radical thinker whom I would like to introduce is Mykola Michnowski. He was born in 1873 and died in 1924. He lived in eastern Ukraine, mainly in Kharkiv, but his writings had a great impact on the Ukrainian nationalists in eastern Galicia, especially on the young members of the Organization of Ukrainian Nationalists, such as Stepan Bandera, Jaroslav Stetsko, and Stepan Lenkovsky. Michnowski's main achievement was the politicization of the ethnicity of the Ukrainian in a biological sense. He demanded a Ukraine for Ukrainians, Ukraina dla Ukraińców, and wanted to define the Ukrainian territories or the living space of the Ukrainians. He argued that the Ukrainians' territory should be established between the Carpathian Mountains and the Caucasus, from which all foes of the Ukrainians should be expelled. Foes for him were Russians, Poles, Magyars, Romanians, and Jews, as long as they rule over us and exploit us. In the Ten Commandments, he wrote in 1904 for the Ukrainian Nationalist Party, he stated, "Do not marry a foreign woman because your children will be your enemies." However, the father of the Ukrainian races was not Michnowski, but Stepan Rudnitsky, who lived from 1887 to 1937. Rudnitsky was a geographer and worked together with Hrushevsky on the concept of the origins of the Ukrainian nation. He tried to define the natural territory of the or the living space of the Ukrainians and argued that race was, after national history, the second most important future of the Ukrainian people. The Ukrainian race was, according to him, beautiful, and the Ukrainians possessed the ability to live and struggle for the existence of the race. Ukrainians, according to Rudnitsky, belong to the tallest nations in Europe. They had a huge chest circumference, perhaps the biggest in Europe. They were slender and agile, which made them very suitable for all kinds of physical work. The point of departure for him was the belief that the good and wealth of nations depends much more on biological than on economic factors. It was first of all race and biological predispositions and not the economic, cultural, social, or political circumstances that determined the well-being of a group. A group was united not by a common identity, but by race, blood, and territory. Rudnitsky believed in a national struggle and a racial struggle, porochba nacjonalna i porochba rasowa. A nation was for him a large community of people, the shape of whose bodies is similar to that of each other, but different from those of other nations. So he actually combined racism with nationalism and used both to create a distinctive, a homogeneous group. Race was for him the factor that made nations with similar languages and cultures different. Although his main concern was the lack of a state in which the Ukrainians would not be treated as second-class citizens, as they were in Poland, and could make their own policies or attend their own schools, he did not regard this as a question of international politics, but addressed it by means of eugenics, racism, and Lebensraum theories. He argued that nations are products of nature, just like animals and plants. Rudnitsky's attitude to the Jews and their coexistence with the Ukrainians was ambiguous. On the one hand, he argued that the Ukrainian peasants were not correct if they believe that intermingling with Jews is a crime. On the other, he condemned marriages with Jews, and from an academic point of view, all neutral ethnologists and Reichelt theoreticians, he wrote, are in agreement and emphasize that the combination of Aryan nations with Jews is bad for both sides. Yet the intermingling with Aryan races, such as Scandinavians, Anglo-Saxons, and Germans, would be beneficial for the Ukrainians. Later in the 1930s and the 1940s, Michnovsky's and Rutnitsky's writing impacted on the OUN, the Organization of Ukrainian Nationalists, and the UPA, Ukrainian Insurgent Army, which was founded by the OUN. For example, the OUN member Mykola Siborski, who lived in the multi-ethnic city of Chernivtsi in Bukovina, wrote in his memoirs that the student fraternity Zaporozhe forbade its members to marry an alien girl, a non-Ukrainian, after reading Michnovsky's Decalogue. The authors of the brochure The Nation as Species, published in 1943 or 1944, quoted Rutnitsky's writing and claimed that a mixed marriage was a crime that should be punished. They wrote, the Ukrainian nation is against mixed marriage and regards it as a crime. The substance of our families must be Ukrainian, father, mother, and children. The family is the most important organic unity, the highest cell of the national collective, and thus we have to keep it purely Ukrainian. The brochure was directly related to what was happening in Western Ukraine at that time. In 1943 and 1944, the UPA, which was created by the OUN, conducted an ethnic cleansing of the Poles in Volhynia and Eastern Galicia. And the leadership of the OUN and UPA demanded that Ukrainians in mixed marriages kill their spouses and children. Now I will go to the modern antisemitism, which evolution is Ukrainian Galicia and Russian Ukraine is actually similar to the evolution of the discourses on racism. In the first half of the 19th century, we have cases such as Taras Shevchenko, the national poet of Ukraine, who in his poem Haidamaki described Jews as the agents of Polish landowners, and the bandits who killed the Jews as national heroes. So it was later related to the socio-economic circumstances than to racism or modern antisemitism. The radicalization of antisemitism in Ukraine happened after the First World War. At the beginning, it was not racist radicalization. Important for this process was the murder of Simon Petliura, a leader of the Ukrainian army, or one of the Ukrainian armies, which fought for a Ukrainian state during and after the First World War. Petliura was murdered in Paris in 1926 by Sholem Schwarzbart, who during the trial claimed to avenge the pogroms that Petliura's army committed in central Ukraine during and after the First World War. After Schwarzbart's trial, Dmytro Donsov, the main ideologist of the Ukrainian fascism, who radicalized the Ukrainian youth in Galicia, claimed, Jews are guilty, terribly guilty, because they helped consolidate Russian rule in Ukraine. But the Jew is not guilty of everything. Russian imperialism is guilty of everything. Only when Russia falls in Ukraine will we be able to settle the Jewish questions. In our country, settle the Jewish question in our country in a way that suits the interests of the Ukrainian people. So Donsov connected the Jews with the Russian imperialism and the Soviet policy in Ukraine and argued that Ukrainians had to overthrow the Soviet empire to deal with the Jews who oppressed the Ukrainians while working for the Soviet Union. The racist type of antisemitism developed slightly after the Judeo-Bolshevik type. Yevhen Konovalets, the first leader of the OUN, claimed in 1934 in a letter to the OUN member Mykola Siborski that mixed marriages with Jews were unacceptable because the Jews are foes of our rebirth. Yuri Milianich argued in a paper in 1929 that Ukrainians have the biggest problem with the Jews in Europe because they have 2 million Jews living in the territory. Yet, in terms of modern antisemitism, the most interesting case are the writings by the OUN ideologist Volodymyr Martinets. In 1938, in London, he published the brochure The Jewish Problem in Ukraine. He made it clear that he admires the Nuremberg Laws and emphasized that Ukrainians needed similar racist regulations like the Germans to deal with the Jews in their country. He argued that Jews were an alien race in every state in which they lived, and thus they were not only a German, a Ukrainian or a Polish, but actually a global problem. He perceived the assimilated Jews as especially dangerous because it was difficult to distinguish them from the Christians, and thus they could contaminate the blood of the non-Jews much easier than the traditional or religious Jews. Martinez demanded that Ukrainians should begin dealing with the Jewish problem immediately and not wait until they will be able to establish a state. He argued that the Jewish problems could be solved only by means of isolation and racist regulations. Jews should have their own schools, newspapers, restaurants, cafes, theaters, brothels, cinemas, cabarets, and they should not be allowed to use the Ukrainian ones. Intermarriage between Jews and Ukrainians has to be stopped and, if possible, forbidden by law. This isolation of the Jewish race would allow the Ukrainians to achieve two goals. First, the Jews would not corrupt the Ukrainian blood. Second, isolation would reduce the number of Jews in Ukraine and finish their parasitic existence. Ukrainians would then begin taking up professions such as tavern owners, physicians, and academics. So this was the last thing I wanted to introduce. Now I will draw a few conclusions and finish. First, racism and modern antisemitism in Ukraine in the late 19th and early 20th century was specific because the political situation in Ukraine was specific. Ukrainians did not have a state. They lived in empires, were politically suppressed by Poles and Russians, and they were a very heterogeneous people. Their culture and language were and are still similar to the Polish and Russian culture and language. So the Ukrainian intellectuals started applying or inventing racial characteristics to distinguish the Ukrainians from the Poles and Russians. They claim that Ukrainians have a different shape of body than Poles and Russians, and thus they are a different race than the Poles and Russians and Jews and should have their own nation. Second, racism radicalized shortly before or after the First World War. Its radicalization began with Michnowski's claim, Ukraine for Ukrainians, and do not marry a foreign woman because your children will be your enemies. In the late 1930s, Ukrainian nationalists wanted to separate the Jews from the Ukrainians by means of racist policies. And during the Second World War, they helped the Germans to exterminate the Jews, and they also killed the Jews and Poles independently of the Nazis. So to summarize, we have an evolution from a national narrative which uses racial characteristics to distinguish Ukrainians from other people, especially Poles and Russians, to a racism which claims that only Ukrainians are allowed to live in the Ukrainian territories, and which motivates the Ukrainians to murder their non-Ukrainian neighbors and even spouses and children. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Grzegorz. Our last speaker is Stefan Vogt. Stefan Vogt is a wissenschaftlicher Mitarbeiter at the Martin Buber Chair for Jewish Thought and Philosophy at the Goethe University in Frankfurt am Main. His main research fields are German Jewish history, the history of nationalism, and the history of colonialism. He is the author of the book Nationaler Sozialismus und Soziale Demokratie, Die sozialdemokratische junge Rechte 1918 bis 1945. And he recently finished the work on his manuscript for his second book, Zionismus und Nationalismus in Deutschland, Studien zur Position und zur Positionierung des deutschen Zionismus im Feld des Nationalismus in Deutschland 1890 bis 1933. The topic of his speech today is Fighting Antisemitism as Jews, Reconsidering the Zionist Responses to Antisemitism in Weimar Germany. Stefan, the floor is yours.
Yes, I also want to thank the organizers for this wonderful organization of this conference and for inviting me to it. I will be speaking of a periphery of a slightly different kind, one that is located inside the center, namely German Jews. And I will also specifically speaking about a group among German Jews who were looking at yet another periphery, and those were, of course, the Zionists. From the late 19th century until the end of the Weimar Republic, one of the most hotly debated issues among German Jews was the question of how to confront anti-Semitism. While answers to this question differed widely already within the liberal majority of German Jews, the emergence of the Zionist movement made this dispute even more furious. The Zionists vigorously attacked the strategy of Abwehr, as proposed and pursued by the liberal Zentralverein Deutscher Staatsbürger Jüdischen Glaubens. This so-called fight against anti-Semitism, wrote Kurt Blumenfeld, who would later become the president of the Zionistische Vereinigung für Deutschland in 1915, really is a fight against Semitism. It was based, according to Blumenfeld, on a total ignorance of the nature of anti-Semitism. Die Wirklichkeit unserer jüdischer Sonderart, he wrote, and I will give you this and other longer quotes in the original German, because in English translation they would lose much of their flavor. So Blumenfeld wrote, die Wirklichkeit unserer jüdischen Sonderart ist der wahre Grund des Antisemitismus. Der Antisemitismus ist ein Zeichen dafür, dass wir noch immer eine wirkende Gemeinschaft sind. Unsere Sonderart wird von den anderen empfunden. The Zentralverein, for his part, accused the Zionists of undermining the Abwehr efforts and supporting anti-Semitism by insisting on the incompatibility of Deutschtum and Judentum, and by declaring that anti-Semitism was a natural, even a understandable reaction to this incompatibility. Judging from Blumenfeld's quote, to which many other similar ones could be added, this accusation was not too far off the mark. The Zionists were indeed convinced that anti-Semitism was inevitable as long as Jews lived among non-Jews. Many even felt that they shared certain ideas about the relationship between Jews and non-Jews with the anti-Semites. Yet other sources suggest that the situation was more complicated than this. Already in 1913, the Zionist Felix Rosenblüth, for example, gave a slightly different description of the dispute with the Zentralverein. Man kann entweder die jüdische Nationalität ableugnen, he wrote, und damit implizite zugeben, dass ihre Existenz den Antisemitismus rechtfertigen würde. Das ist die Methode des Zentralvereins. Oder man kann die Existenz der jüdischen Nationalität zugeben, aber bestreiten, dass sie dem Antisemitismus auch nur den mindesten Anspruch gestattet. Das ist die Methode des Zionismus. Rosenblüth's statement not only provides an argument against the criticism of the Zentralverein, which is worth considering, it also contradicts the verdict of most of the scholarship, which, depending on the ideological perspective, judged Zionism with the underestimation of, indifference to, or even compliance with anti-Semitism. Compared to the work of the Zentralverein, the Zionists indeed confront anti-Semitism on a much less intensive level. This comparison, however, is not totally fair, considering the fact that in contrast to the Zionist movement, the Zentralverein was established explicitly as an Abwehrverein. It also tends to overlook ways of confronting anti-Semitism that do not fit into the classical concept of Abwehr. Both for a quantitative and for a qualitative reassessment, it is necessary to analyze the Zionist responses to anti-Semitism in their own right, outside of the often polemic competition with the Zentralverein. In this paper, I want to show that fighting anti-Semitism played a far greater role in Zionist politics during the Weimar period than it is usually conceded. To do this, I will describe the scope of the Zionist fight against anti-Semitism and the various forms this fight took on. In a second step, I want to demonstrate that the Zionist fight against anti-Semitism was not a desultory and superficial activity, but rather guided by a consistent ideological concept. The Zionists insisted to address the problem of anti-Semitism from the basis of an emphatically avowed ethnic identity as Jews, instead of claiming equality, which they felt could and should not be reached. The Zionists wanted to fight anti-Semitism by insisting on difference. I will argue that the specific quality of this strategy is best understood if concepts of post-colonial critique are applied. The purpose of this argument, however, is not to rehabilitate Zionist politics vis-à-vis anti-Semitism. Rather, I want to suggest a different angle of critique which acknowledges the innovative elements of this politics while drawing attention to the fundamental problems inherent in any form of identity politics. Even though the development in Palestine and internal problems of the Zionist movement did indeed make up the bulk of the articles published in the Jüdische Rundschau, the official newspaper of the German Zionist Federation, reports and discussions of anti-Semitism were a consistent feature during the Weimar years too. Immediately after the war, the Zionists reacted to the anti-Semitic wave that swept across the country with numerous articles in the Rundschau as well as in other Jewish journals. Almost all of these articles insisted that although anti-Semitism was an ineradicable aspect of Jewish life in the diaspora, the rights, the property, and the life of the Jews should be actively defended. This was also the position of many Zionist grassroots activists. The central office in Berlin was a bit more reluctant in this respect, but in January 1923, it advised the various branches of the organization to participate in joint Jewish defense activities if Jews were directly attacked, and to publicly propagate the idea of Jewish co-equality, the German word would be Ebenbürtigkeit, even at anti-Semitic gatherings. In addition, the Zionists collected material about anti-Semitism and planned to publish several brochures on the topic. When in 1923 anti-Semitism and especially anti-Semitic violence reached unprecedented levels in Germany, the Zionists were again at the forefront of publicly denouncing these developments. The Jüdische Rundschau reported extensively on the series of riots and pogroms which took place in several parts of the country and climaxed in the Berlin Scheunenviertel on November 5th. The German Zionist Federation devoted a section of its June 23 Delegiertentag in Dresden, as well as several meetings of the Landesvorstand and the Zentralkomitee, its highest executive bodies, exclusively to the discussion of the anti-Semitic events and the steps to be taken. Consultations were held with the Berlin Jewish community, the Jewish veterans organization Reichsbund Jüdischer Frontsoldaten, and even with the Zentralverein, which resulted in the formation of a joint committee on actions against anti-Semitism. After the dissolution of this committee due to the political rivalry with the Zentralverein in early 1924, the Zionists established a separate committee with the purpose of developing political, propagandistic, but also legal strategies to fight anti-Semitism. An immediate result of the work of the Zionist committee was the abandonment of the total neutrality towards Weimar party politics. In April 1924, the Landesvorstand advised the regional branches to mobilize Jewish votes at the upcoming Reichstag election against the anti-Semitic parties, which, as it was explained, were all right-wing parties, as well as against parties who would cooperate with those. The Jüdische Rundschau published appeals to this effect for all subsequent Reichstag elections, as well as a recommendation to vote for Hindenburg and against Hitler at the presidential elections of 1932. Zionist propaganda efforts against anti-Semitism did not cease either during the relatively calm middle years of the Weimar Republic. The report to the Delegiertentag in Breslau 1928 lists seven public meetings on this topic for the period between January 1927 and May 1928. Already in 1926, the Zionist Jüdische Verlag had published one of the first scholarly studies on anti-Semitism, Fritz Bernstein's Der Antisemitismus als Gruppenerscheinung. 1 year later appeared Arnold Zweig's study on the same topic, titled Caliban oder Politik und Leidenschaft. The rise of National Socialism since 1929 gave additional urgency to the fight against anti-Semitism, and this was also felt among the Zionists. Several local branches pressed for cooperation with the Zentralverein. This, as well as more general questions of the Zionist strategy against anti-Semitism, was discussed extensively in a series of meetings of the central executive bodies of the German Zionist Federation in the period leading up to the September 1930 Reichstag elections. The Zionists were very much aware that this would be a fateful election, especially for German Jews. They agreed to form a Reichstagswahlausschuss, a joint committee with the Zentralverein, the Reichsbund Jüdischer Frontsoldaten, the Berlin Jewish Community, and the Bnei Brit Lodge, whose purpose was to support candidates who would confront anti-Semitism during the election campaign. This was again an extremely uneasy cooperation with very limited success, and the Reichstagswahlausschuss dissolved immediately after the elections. The Zionists resumed their critique of the Abwehr strategy of the Zentralverein, but they did not withdraw from the fight against anti-Semitism. Already in February 1930, they had established their own ad hoc committee, which was later transformed into a permanent Antisemitismus Kommission. During the last years of the Weimar Republic, the Jüdische Rundschau reported extensively on the spread of anti-Semitism and the rise of National Socialism, insisting that this posed a fundamental threat to the Jewish existence in Germany. This brief account of the Zionist activities against German anti-Semitism would not be complete without mentioning that at least in two cases, the Zionists also participated in the organization of militant self-defense. During the anti-Semitic riots and pogroms of 1923, Zionist youth groups teamed up with the Reichsbund Jüdischer Frontsoldaten to set up Jewish defense squads. In 1927, members of the Zionist sports club Maccabi formed again with the Reichsbund, the Jüdische Abwehrdienst in Berlin, which protected synagogues and monitored Nazi meetings to prevent ensuing violence against Jews. The Abwehrdienst most likely also intervened in the anti-Semitic Kurfürstendamm riots in Berlin in September 1931. The extent, continuity, and diversity of Zionist activities clearly contradict the prevailing view of Zionist underestimation of and indifference towards anti-Semitism in the Weimar Republic. To be sure, the Zionists often subordinated their Abwehr efforts to more genuine Zionist goals, especially the promotion of and propaganda for Jewish settlement in Palestine. From the Zionist point of view, however, this was not necessarily a contradiction. Rather, confronting anti-Semitism only made sense in the ideological framework of Zionism. The practical Abwehr, which was at the center of the work of the Zentralverein, did play a significant role in the Zionist politics during the Weimar Republic, but was much less important than confronting it ideologically. It was on this ideological level where Zionists developed a coherent and distinct strategy against anti-Semitism. And this brings me to the second part of my paper. Throughout the Weimar years, the Zionists spent considerable effort on analyzing the reasons for anti-Semitism and on disseminating their views to the Jewish public. One of the basic assumptions was already stated in Blumenfeld's programmatic article quoted at the beginning of this paper. Anti-Semitism, he claimed, was an inevitable consequence of the diaspora. Everywhere where two nations border on each other, the difference between these nations would produce tensions, a Randspannungsgefühl, as he called it. In the case of the Jews, Blumenfeld argued, this effect was omnipresent. Auch der Antisemitismus ist nichts anderes als ein höchst intensives Randspannungsgefühl. Überall bilden die Juden Grenzen, überall berühren sie sich mit anderen. The mantra of the inevitability of antisemitism in the diaspora was repeated numerous times in Zionist articles, pamphlets, and speeches. This was, of course, a major argument for their primary goal, emigration to Palestine, which could be presented as the sole way of really getting rid of anti-Semitism. It was also a major reason why the Zionists deemed practical Abwehr efforts much less important than the Zentralverein did. From the Zionist perspective, however, this inevitability followed with necessity from their essentialist concept of the nation in general and of Jews and of Jewry in particular. To be sure, this was a highly problematic perspective, and I will get back to this in a minute. Paradoxically, however, it also led the Zionists to important insights into the ideological structure of anti-Semitism. Fritz Bernstein's book, for example, focused on the role anti-Semitic ideology played for the construction and safeguarding of the inner coherence of the anti-Semitic collective, an issue that is central to the study of anti-Semitism today. Even more notably, the Zionists reached the conclusion that anti-Semitism was fundamentally independent from the actions and characteristics of the Jews. No matter how well or unsuspicious the Jews would behave, anti-Semites would still find their presence unacceptable. This notion, too, has clearly been confirmed by modern research on anti-Semitism. On this basis, the Zionists also insisted that anti-Semitism was always directed at the Jews as such, not at some specific Jewish individual or group, such as, for example, the Ostjuden. It, was this understanding of anti-Semitism that informed the Zionist attacks against the Abwehr strategy of the Zentralverein. Of course, organizational rivalry and the Zionist general rejection of anything that smacked of assimilation were crucial here as well. Yet their criticism of the Zentralverein was much more substantial than that. The Zionists were convinced that it was useless to insist on the equality or the national loyalty of the Jews, as anti-Semites would not care how German Jews would feel or present themselves. Even worse, this strategy the Zionists insisted increased anti-Semitism by providing it with the argument that the Jews would camouflage their identity and thus weaken Jewish defense. At the center of the alternative strategy against anti-Semitism developed by the Zionists lay the notion of the strengthening of Jewish self-confidence. This is a quote. If the Jews would be more self-confident, it was argued, they would be less vulnerable to anti-Semitism. The duty of Zionism was thus to raise the feeling of dignity among the Jews. Because of the assumed inevitability of anti-Semitism, and because neither rational argumentation nor good behavior of the Jews would convince anti-Semites that they were wrong, the Zionists directed their strategy quite logically, almost entirely towards Jews. As Siegfried Kanowitz put it, es kommt für uns nicht auf Aufklärungsarbeit unter Nichtjuden an, sondern wir müssen den Juden die innere Sicherheit gegenüber dem Antisemitismus geben. A major way to achieve this inner security was the promotion of solidarity among Jews. To contain this, the spiritual, political, and especially also the economical damages which anti-Semitism could inflict on Jews, the Zionists called on German Jewry to establish communal structures of Jewish self-help. Yet the Zionist strategy against anti-Semitism was not only directed inward. If Jews would be more self-confident, the Zionists argued, they would also be able to finally achieve co-equality. Ebenbürtigkeit. Jews would then be able to confront other nations not as powerless and discriminated minority, but on par. This, the Zionists believed, would in the end also lead the non-Jewish world to accept the Jews as Jews. The goal of the fight against anti-Semitism in this concept should not be integration, but recognition. It should not be Gleichheit, but Gleichwertigkeit. If integration and equality were illusions and undesirable ones at that, the insistence on difference remained the only viable way to confront discrimination and denigration and therefore to fight anti-Semitism. Wir haben die Aufgabe zu zeigen, concluded Georg Landauer in the guidelines he presented to the Antisemitismus-Kommission in 1931, dass Identifikation von Deutschtum und Judentum keine Realität ist und dass ein Versuch, sie der Umwelt zu suggerieren, eine verfehlte Spekulation ist. Dass vielmehr im Gegenteil das moderne Denken von der Existenzberechtigung und Freiheit der Sondergruppen, auch der Nationalen, ausgeht und daher der Kampf um Gleichberechtigung und der Anerkennung unseres nationalen Andersseins aussichtsvoller ist. The Zionist strategy against anti-Semitism thus differed radically from the Abwehr strategy of the Zentralverein, but it was certainly no less comprehensive and consistent. Its basic principle was to confront anti-Semitism not as Germans, but as Jews. Seen from today's perspective, this strategy appears as strikingly modern. It meets all the criteria for what postcolonial theorists such as Stuart Hall have called identity politics. The Zionist strategy was to avow the identification of Jews, redefine it as a positive attribute, and insist on the separation from and difference to the non-Jews, of course. On this basis, they aimed at confronting the non-Jews on eye level, challenging the very structure of the relationship between the hegemonial society and the marginal group. The goal of this strategy was not to overcome anti-Semitism, but to enable the Jews to brace themselves against its assault and to eventually make them immune. The Zionists believed that this was a much more powerful and effective approach than trying to blend into the non-Jewish society. Postcolonial theory, as well as the experiences made in postcolonial politics, suggest that they were not totally wrong. At the same time, however, the Zionist strategy against anti-Semitism produced a series of new problems, all of which were present in other forms of identity politics as well. Based on the principles of exclusion towards the outside and the collective and homogenization towards the inside, the concept of identity always has repressive effects. And these effects are greatly increased through the inherent essentialist tendency of identity politics. While post-colonial theorists such as Hall have searched for ways to contain this tendency, the Zionists, such just as many post-colonial movements, readily embraced it. There is, of course, a great difference between hegemonial and subaltern identity politics, and in the confrontation with German anti-Semitism, Zionist identity politics certainly was of the latter type. However, as again post-colonial theory has shown, both are at the same time intimately intertwined. Subaltern identity politics has no other choice but to emulate hegemonial forms. And this is why the Zionists could feel a measure of ideological affinity to certain aspects of anti-Semitic thought. It is also the background for the attempts of some German Zionists to discuss the Jewish question with supposedly moderate anti-Semites such as Wilhelm Stapel or Max Hildebert Böhm. On the basis of identity politics, the Zionists were thus not able to categorically reject the ideology of anti-Semitism, and this seriously harmed their ability to fight it. They were, however, indeed able to develop an innovative strategy to defend the Jews against anti-Semitism. For German Jews who were facing the Nazi threat without much support from the non-Jewish society, this was maybe an even more important achievement. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the four very interesting contributions. We have approximately 25 minutes left for discussion. The floor is open for your questions and comments.
Hi, first of all, thanks very much for the presentations. I thought they were very, very interesting. So I've got a couple of very short questions. And the first question is for Alphonse and Wanut. So you both talked about the link that anti-Semites made between anti-Semitism and Freemasonry. One of you is talking about a Catholic country and the other one is talking about an Orthodox country. So I come from a Freemason background. My family are Freemasons kind of going back. And in the UK, you don't really have this very strong link, not such a strong link between Freemasonry and anti-Semitism. I'm just wondering, it might seem a very stupid question, but could you just explain a bit about why that link is so strong? Because it's not really clear to me why they would have this, this assumption between Freemasonry and Judaism. And the other question is for Gregor, which is you mentioned that there's a lack of literature on anti-Semitism in Ukraine, and that you wrote about Bandera. I'm just wondering, do you have any thoughts on the prospects for future publications from Ukrainian historians about anti-Semitism, given the current political atmosphere in Ukraine? That Bandera is now a national hero, and you're not really meant to criticize him, and that there's a kind of nationalistic atmosphere there at the moment. So I just wondering if you could say something about the prospects for kind of future research by Ukrainian historians on this part of Second World War history. So. And before.
Yeah, if I can start this. We'll answer this probably shortly. There is a division between. There is a group of scholars who publish critical, who investigate critically the fascism, Holocaust, and all these other difficult subjects, but their studies are not really received in Ukraine. So, for example, my book was hugely marginalized. Until it was published, it was discussed because nobody read it, and I was, for example, invited to speak about my dissertation in Kiev, and six lectures were planned, but only one happened, and there were many people from the right-wing Svoboda Party who disapproved of this lecture, and after it was published, there was no reception in Ukraine. It was ignored, and the same is happening to other people who publish about the Holocaust, fascism, and other studies. There is a small group of scholars in Ukraine who try to investigate the fascism, for example, but they are not really working in the way I would work, or John Paul Himka would work, or Marko Czarenik would work. They invent their own theories, and they, for example, look at the fascism and radical nationalism as integral nationalism and are inventing a third way, which is perhaps the only thing they can do, because if they would openly publish about what happened in Ukraine, they will be disapproved by other scholars, as I was and as many other scholars were, who did this. So this is the question of the political situation, which doesn't really allow to work critically about Ukraine and publish critically in Ukraine. Although, for example, one study by who wrote this about Eastern Ukraine was translated into Ukraine, but other studies, like for example the book by Franziska Broda, it was translated into Ukrainian about 5 years ago, but then the publisher refused to publish this. So I don't know when this will change, when this will stop, perhaps only then when the situation in Ukraine will become stable, when the war and all this conflict which happened in Ukraine will stop, and then perhaps only then the scholars will be able to publish their work. And it is also the question of the society, which is not really ready to read all these things during the war. For example, fascism is used by the Russian propaganda to disapprove of certain parties in Ukraine, and it is used in a completely different way than scholars publish about fascism. So this is the problem. If I publish something about fascism, the people in Ukraine read it differently as I have written this. So I think it might take some years.
Okay, Freemasonry and Orthodoxy, if I understood correctly your question. Until the beginning of 1920s, the Orthodox Church has no problem whatsoever with Freemasonry. Actually, I don't think that the clergymen knew what Freemasonry really was. But there are two things that happened in the beginning of 1920s. The first was the publishing of the Protocols of the Elders of Zion, I think the 1922 edition in Cluj-Napoca. This was a city in Transylvania. And the importance that was given to this book by the extreme ultra-nationalist right-wing movements, like, you know, the movements I mentioned. And the church internalized this question, and actually they came to grip with this whole issue of Freemasonry in 1937, when on 11th of March 1937, the Holy Synod, you know, the gathering of all Orthodox bishops of the Romanian Orthodox Church, produced an edict, an official edict condemning Freemasonry. There were four counts in which Freemasonry was condemned. First, that it was produced by Satan. Second, that Freemasonry somehow subdued Romanian economics and Romanian culture to a foreign spirit. But in Romanian, the word for foreign was actually mostly associated with the Jews. The third count was that Freemasonry is anti-Christian. And the fourth count was that Freemasonry was fighting against the Romanian nation. The guy who produced the document was not the whole body of the bishops, but actually just one. It was Nicolae Bolan of Transylvania, who was at that time a reputed supporter of the Iron Guard and one of the most, I would say, the most hideous Orthodox clergyman in the Romanian Orthodox Church, a guy who was able to survive any change of regime, from fascist to Antonescu to Holocaust and the communists, and he died happily ever after in 1955. Thank you very much.
Yeah, at the beginning of 19th century, the Spanish crown had a long tradition of fighting heretical tendencies. The Inquisition fought against, not against Jews, but against converted Jews, and Freemasons were also heretical, so the Inquisition had a long tradition in fighting against these two. And this is the origin of this identification. At the end of 19th century, it's true that we find many Freemasons in all conspiracies to fight against the conservative regimes. And actually, the president of the Second Republic, Manuel Azaña, he was Freemason, and many other liberal and progressive politicians were Freemasons. And at this particular moment, Spain is also importing and translating all the anti-Semitic books from France. La France Juive, is translated. Of course, the protocols of the elders of science are also translated. And the Spanish Catholic Rite finds that they are the same, Jews and Freemasons. They are all conspiring against the Church. And this is the origin, in my opinion, of this confusion between Freemasons and Jews.
And there is another factor. This idea, which is, I think, you'll find it throughout Europe, of the Judeo-Bolshevik conspiracy, especially after the end of the Russian Revolution. Yeah, and actually, this is, I think, it's a key topic in both the Orthodox Church, both the Catholic, and also the secular realms all over Europe. This generates a feeling of distress, a feeling of malaise towards Freemasonry.
Hi, I'm Faith Hillis from the University of Chicago, and I'd like to thank everyone for a really great panel. My question is for Grzegorz. I was really struck in your paper. I think all of the individuals you spoke about, except I think for Rudnitsky and Martinets, are from actually Russian Ukraine, so they're born in the Russian Empire and end up in Galicia. And I'm wondering if you could just tell us a little bit more about what these men are reading and what their influences are. To what extent are they influenced by sort of traditional Russian anti-Semitism, even though they're, of course, later agitating against the Russian Empire and Russian nationalism? And to what extent are they influenced by European racial theorists? So which of these two directions would you say is more important, or are they sort of equally important?
Yeah, I choose Galicia because Galicia is the place where it was possible to publish books. In Russian Ukraine, after the Elms Ukaz, it was not possible. So the people from Russian Ukraine, if they wanted to publish something in Ukraine, they published this in Galicia, or they moved to Galicia, like, for example, Hrushevsky. And my feeling is that there is, as I said, there is only one article by me about 19th century and racism and anti-Semitism in Ukraine, so we don't know really anything about the subject. My feeling is that they invent their own racist and anti-Semitic discourse, which helps them. The racist discourse helps them to define the Ukrainian nation, so they find all this possible, invent all this possible characteristic, like how the Ukrainians are different from the Poles and from the Russians. And it would be interesting to look when did they took it from. But until now I haven't investigated this. So I don't know if it is also possible by one person. Actually, it is a thing what the Ukrainian scholars in Ukraine should do. But they don't do this, so I have written one article. Actually, it is only a part of an article about racism in Ukraine in the 19th century. And it should be investigated much deeply than I did. And yeah, it is true. So, for example, Donsov, he was born in Eastern Ukraine, and Antonovich was an Eastern Ukrainian or a Russian Ukrainian. And interesting is the reception of the writings in Ukraine, especially in the interwar period. So the OUN, the Ukrainian radical nationalists, read this text, and they adopt them to their own ideology, and then they claim that during the war that the Ukrainians should kill their children if they are Polish, and they should kill their wives if they are Polish, and they take this from the people who lived in Russian Ukraine. Yeah, so generally I would say it is Ukrainian scholars should start investigate this subject and write one or two books, and then we will know more about this subject.
Okay.
So question for Alphonse. You talked very briefly at the end about how this is maybe also questioned about calling into question the transition and whether or not what we're seeing is a generational conflict in Spain between the transition generation and the post-transition generation, which is wrapped up in things like the economic crisis, the perception of corruption and things like this, linking it back to the continuities of the transition, amnesty and amnesia that allowed these people to remain in power when they should have been swept away post-transition, and that bringing out the past or debating the past is a way of calling the transition into question, and in turn to delegitimize the transition elite, if I'm kind of making sense.
Yeah, well, was this a question? I mean, or
am I barking up the wrong tree?
Yeah, I agree with you. There's this Margalida Capella, she's professor of international law in Mallorca, and she this revolution of the year 2000, Adam Schneider was describing, with the exhumation of mass graves, she called it the grandsons' revolt, the grandsons of those who fought in the civil war, who were Erasmus students in Germany or in Italy or in France. They came back and they realized that something was wrong in our country. And yeah, they started questioning the transition, question the lack of transitional justice, and of course, questioning the statu quo of 1978. And I do think that the economic and also institutional crisis we are living now in Spain, it has to do with this conflict, generational conflict. Yeah.
Laura is the next comment. Jana, Laura, please. And then it would be Dimitrios and Raul, just to.
Excuse me, Laura. Hello, I'm Laura Almagor. I'm a junior fellow here at the VWI. And my question is actually for Stefan Vogt, who may have thought that he was off the hook, but he's not. So in Central Eastern Europe after 1906, the Helsingfors Conference, the Zionists started to engage and be involved in so-called Gegenwartsarbeit, work in the presence, very much attached to the Bundist-introduced concept of Deutschkeit, here-ness. This work was more cultural work, although that by default became also very politicized and political. And I was wondering if you could reflect a bit on whether the anti-Semitism of the Zionists, the Weimar Republic, somehow fits into this concept of Gegenwartsarbeit, and if maybe even in your sources you found references to this explicit engagement with this project that was one of the official stances of the Zionist movement after 1906. Thank you.
Yeah, well, there was also in Germany the debate about Gegenwartsarbeit among the Zionists, and also many Zionists consider themselves engaging into Gegenwartsarbeit. They even founded a political party, the Jüdische Volkspartei, which ran for elections in the Jewish communities. And of course, also this Gegenwartsarbeit in the Weimar period was considered to be part of the, in a way, to be part of the strategy against anti-Semitism insofar as it strengthened Jewish identity and Jewish self-confidence. And this was the central element of their strategy. So yes, this existed, and also the term existed, and also the debate about it existed. And there was, if I presented it as a kind of a clicker strategy, that might have made it a bit too easy, because there was of course a lot of debate about that, how far you should go in engaging in this kind of Abwehr and Gegenwartsarbeit, and how far you should concentrate on the immigration issue, and how far any kind of cooperation with the Zentralverein and the other ideological enemies within the Jewish part of the society should go. But in a way, this is a parallel development that what you describe from Central and Eastern Europe.
I'd like to thank all four speakers. If I may, two questions to Alphonse. The period that you spoke about, in which the discourse of filosofardismo was developed, the 1890s, if I'm correct, was also a period which coincided with Spain's loss of empire, Spanish-American War and the like. Do you believe that played a role in this discovery or rediscovery, whether you want the prefix re or not, of the Sephardic heritage of Spain? My second question is about this issue of citizenship. For example, Spain gave citizenship to Jews in Salonika in Greece. How were those laws practically enforced? What was the applicability? For example, did the Spanish consul in Salonika oblige them to do certain things? Were they given residency rights in metropolitan Spain? How did it work? That's a question. Thanks.
Thank you. Yeah, there's a direct relation between the loss of Cuba and Puerto Rico in 1898 and the new interest of Spain for the Ottoman Empire and for Morocco. Spain had some territories in Africa, but it was not especially interested in Africa. After the loss of Cuba and Puerto Rico, the political elites turned the light to Africa. They are interested in colonizing Morocco, and yeah, this also influenced this filosofardismo. For the second question, according to the civil code, in order to get Spanish citizenship, you had to go to Madrid, and you had to sign a document. And in this royal decree of 1924, there was an exception. The Sephardic Jews could just make a declaration and sign the documents before the Spanish diplomats. Well, actually, it's normal. You cannot force thousands of people to travel to Madrid just to sign a document. But interestingly, Ospina and Marquina, they discovered an instruction sent by the Ministry of Foreign Affairs to the Spanish representatives in the Balkans and in Greece, asking them not to facilitate Jewish immigration to Spain and not to give a lot of publicity to this royal decree. So was this exception on the royal decree of 1924 just, decided for practical reason, or was it to prevent the Spanish Jewish immigration to Spain? Yeah? So at the end, the Spanish representatives were the ones who signed the document granting the Spanish citizenship.
Well, thank you for four very interesting presentations. One thing which I found, I'm sort of trying to link the four, although they're very different, but there's one thing which I find important in all four of them, and that's how central a role self-representations play in the way that anti-Semitism plays out. I mean, the self-perceptions, whether it's Spain's trying to define itself as philosophardic, whether it's Romanian theologians trying to define their corpus of biblical scholarship, or whether it's Ukrainians trying to define their national identity, it's always more, I mean, starting from Stefan's comment that it's quite independent of the characteristics of the Jews, it has always more to do with the characteristics of the group than of the Jews themselves. And I was wondering if you can comment on this in your four different contexts. And some specific questions, like one for Alphonse, just because I don't know anything about it, the association of Jew and Catalan. That's, I mean, the association of Jews with Freemasonry and the Judeo-Bolshevik trope are ideas that travel around Europe, but this one is specific to Spain, and I would be curious to know more about it, like what was behind it, how does this narrative of association between Jews and Catalans played out. And second is to Grzegorz and Jonas. I mean, the issue of racism is obviously, I think, very different. You both used the word racism, and I would sort of, myself, in the context of Romania, I would also apply it along the lines of the ones that Grzegorz uses. So I see racism as a biological concept, which in the Romanian case I don't think is the case. The notion of, I was wondering how would you answer to this question, the notion of conversion, which for a biological racist view of Jewishness would not be ever acceptable, but it is obviously acceptable for the extreme right in Romania, whether we're talking about only if we're talking about the Iron Guard, because if you talk about the League of National Christian Defense, there you see an exclusion based on biological criteria rather than religious ones, whereas in the Iron Guard you see converted Jews being members and even, you know, legionary leaders. So If we use racism in the Romanian context, we really have to clarify what we mean by it. And I wonder if the concept even, you know, survives the fact that it's very non-biological. And I think if you look at, again, if you look at self-representations in the two cases, I think that sort of clarifies. Thanks. Sorry for being too long.
Yeah, very, very short. According to anti-Semitic prejudices, Jews are stingy. They are always rich and they are trying to suck the Christians' money, Christians' blood. And according to prejudices, Catalans are also stingy. And Catalonia is not well known for having experienced industrial revolution before the rest of Spain. And of course, Catalans are also well known because of causing problems, asking for autonomy, asking for reforms in Spain, etc. And that's the origin of this identification. And you find that. Spanish nationalist propagandists, they used the same caricatures and even pictures that were being used in Germany to characterize the Jews. And that's the origin. And that's also the origin of why some groups in the Catalan oppositions to Franquismo, they considered themselves as very close to Jews, and that's maybe the origin of why a Catalan poet who was very active against Franquismo, Salvador Espriu, he wrote his famous poem Sefarad, representing the liberal and tolerant Spain in opposition to the intolerant Spain.
To respond to your question, suggestion, or comment about religious theological racism and why I use the term racism, and the fact that you're not alone in saying that Romanian Orthodox Church didn't possess a racist ideology, fascist ideology. Vladimir Solonari, in his book Purifying the Nation, is making the same argument, but I think he's wrong, and I already told him. I will give you only one sharp example. In 1942, there is a book which he comments in a book edited by Rory here present, called Race and Religion, written by a priest in Sibiu Theological Academy, Liviu Stan. This book proves without doubt that Liviu Stan was a member of the Iron Guard, he was a fascist in his early years, but he was published in 1942, and he proves without doubt that there is a racist which can be theological, that all the racist categories, blood, craniology, all these kind of things can have a theological backing. And second, there are other people. For example, I don't think that the Legion of Archangel Michael, it's a single body. I don't think the Legion of Archangel Michael, it's a single political organism, but it has multi-layers, multi-stratas, and there is this kind of racist tendons, Ioan Foti, Randa, who have this kind of racist tracking and who have this kind of racist influence. And I think that this opens new avenue of research. If you look, for example, just at Liviu Stan, who is commenting in the same time Bulletin Etnopolitico and from Sibiu, and he's polemizing with Iuliu Hațegan and all this school from Cluj-Napoca. So I think there is this kind of racist Orthodox theology. Of course, you are right. Maybe not in my paper, but I think there is. Thank you.
Okay, there is a last question.
Thank you for your talks. I have a question for Mr. Rosulinski-Liebe. You spoke about the political situation in Galicia in relation to racist and anti-Semitic tendencies. And I would like to ask, how would you assess the role of the state and the Habsburg authority in this context? So was the state interested in counteracting racism and especially anti-Semitism? Was its position rather passive, or did it even fuel these tendencies? I realize this is not a short question, but maybe you could give a short overview. Thank you.
Thank you. I will first go to the question of Raoul. I think we have racism is a complex phenomenon, and it is depends where and when it develops. And we have different concepts of racism in Europe in the 19th century and then in the 20th century. And I think we have to define it depending when we study this and about which group we speak. And for example, in the OUN, the one member, OUN member Mykola Sziborski, about whom I mentioned during the talk, he had a Jewish wife. I don't know if he was married, but he lived with this woman together, and for a certain period of time it was not a problem for the organization. But then, when the racists from Nazi Germany impacted the discourses of the OUN, the Efren Konovalis, the leader of the OUN, wrote in the letter he should stop being her friend or husband because it is against our policy. So we see how this changes in the OUN and the same for all other situations. The second question about the role of the Habsburg policies, I don't know much about this. And I think we should study this. I mean, that the strange thing about Ukraine and Galicia is there was a group of scholars at the Institut für Osteuropäische Geschichte in Wien, and they work on Galicia for about 10 years, and about 20 PhD theses were written there, and nobody was dealing with racism or antisemitism, as far as I know, or maybe racism and antisemitism were some aspects of some dissertations, but it was no single work was written directly about this subject or about the role of the Habsburg policies in these discourses. So I am not really able to answer this question.
Okay, our time for the discussion is unfortunately over. I have to close the panel, but before I close it, I would like to bring one more thing to your attention. Please take all your belongings with you, because we're not coming back to the Palais Epstein. The conference is going to continue at 3 o'clock at the Österreichisches Theatermuseum on Lobkowitzplatz. If you need to know how to get there, ask us. Afterwards, thank you very much for your time and for your attention, and enjoy your lunch break.